And thank you, Steph.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to Neuroscience Grand Rounds from the Pacific Neuroscience Institute in Providence, Southern California. We're very, very excited today to have our team and guest speaker. Dr. Martha Koo is a psychiatrist and psychoanalyst with expertise in modulatory treatment interventions for mental health. She completed her undergraduate studies at Princeton University, medical training at UCLA School of Medicine, where she stayed on for residency. She's currently board certified in psychiatry and in addiction medicine, and she's certified in psychedelic assisted therapy by the California Institute of Integral Studies that has been discussed in the previous psychedelics lecture. She's a pioneer in transcranial magnetic stimulation, or TMS for short, which she'll be speaking about today. And she opened her first TMS therapy center back already 15 years ago. It's incredible how time has flown. She's currently the chief medical officer of Your Behavioral Health, a Southern California-based in-network behavioral health company that offers a full continuum of mental health care that she will thankfully be speaking about today. And it includes both the Neuro Wellness Spa, which has 9 outpatient psychiatry clinics for medical management, TMS, and magnetic e-resonance therapy. She also Clear Behavioral Health, which I had the opportunity to visit a couple of weeks ago and was very excited about having this in our neck of the woods, where there's multiple higher level of care facilities for detoxification, residential therapy, and partial hospitalization for mental illness, substance use disorder, and dual diagnoses, as well as the New Life Hosts with 3 sober living facilities for long-term addiction aftercare. She really is trying to go after these problems in a 360-degree fashion. And I'm so excited on behalf of the Pacific Neuroscience Institute of partnering with Dr. Koo and her group. So with that, to speak on TMS, Dr. Koo, the floor is yours. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Sivakumar. I really appreciate the warm welcome. And thank you, Elizabeth and Mary, for helping coordinate this, as well as Pamela, who's on our side. I'm going to share my screen. It's a little bit hard when I can't see all the attendees. So if someone could help, I want this to be a give and take dialogue. I know there's a lot of people listening, but feel free to hop out. And if there's questions, just speak up, or if someone can help look at the chat, that would be good for me. And let me try to shut this because it's
gonna while you set that up, Dr. Koo, I will go ahead and help you with that. They will be typing their questions in the Q&A. And if anybody has a burning question that they want to do, Dr. Koo has opened up the opportunity to raise the hand, and Elizabeth can go ahead and bring you up to the group so you may speak and ask your question.
Awesome. Thank you. So we'll just go ahead and start. As already referenced, I'm going to talk about transcranial magnetic stimulation today, and I'm really excited. Apologies if anybody's disappointed about the CME, but I think you're going to be super excited to hear about TMS. And it's really interesting to me because, you know, this has been a tool that has been around since the 1980s, and a lot of people are still unaware of it. It was actually FDA indicated for depression in 2008, and it's a really important intervention in neuroscience, probably the best thing I'll see in my lifetime in psychiatry. And it's fully covered by insurance for several indications, and I think more to come. So if you're in, you know, I think most of us are touched by depression, addiction, anxiety disorders in our general practices. But this is going to have far-reaching results in terms of even people that deal with cognitive declines, pain management. So I think that you're going to see that there's going to be a big overlap, I think, with a lot of areas of medicine so far. So what I'd like to do is I'm just going to briefly touch on major depressive episodes. I think we're all familiar with it, but just because that was the first indication and highlight how much of a public health problem it really is for us. Look at treatment resistant depression, as well as some disparities in mental health and mental health care, and then go ahead and talk about TMS, MERT therapy, magnetic e-resonance therapy, which is a specific type of personalized TMS. And then I've set up the slides really after just to have a bunch of FAQs and referral tips. I think that you will all have access to my slides. And I think that's been a nice way that sort of people have enjoyed getting the information, because it's a lot of questions that patients would pretty much ask you directly. And then if we have time, we'll go over a little bit of Neuro Wellness Spa and Clear Behavioral Health and New Life Houses, which are services that are accessible in the Southern California region. So everybody knows, right? Depression, huge amount of morbidity, mortality, economic costs around the world. Point prevalence of 8%, usually 10%, usually for women, 6% for men, and an actually lifetime prevalence of 18 and almost a half percent. I see a hand up. Is there a question? Maybe not. The importance of depression in and of itself is significant, as highlighted, but in terms of when we just look at some of the major illnesses that all our patients struggle with, we look at obesity, cardiovascular disease, and you sort of see the interplay, just to use those as an example. So some of the stats, right? People with diabetes, right? 2 to 3 times more likely to have depression than people without. People with obesity, 55% increased risk of developing depression over time. Adults with depression have a 64% greater risk of coronary artery disease, and a depressed coronary artery disease patient has a 59% increased likelihood of a future adverse event. So the mind-body connection, the importance of whole physical and mental wellness, I think is, doesn't surprise any of us now. I think most of us are approaching our patients in a much more holistic and hopefully preventative manner. Forward. Few other stats there, right? 11% of primary care visits usually have depression listed as the diagnosis. Over 12% of emergency department visits have depression as a significant diagnosis. And obviously the mortality of suicides with depression is significant. So at any sort of point in time, I've already mentioned about 21 million adults with depression. Only about 2/3 of those get treated actually, and only about 1/3 of those get well treated. And when we say like well treated, I'm talking about full remission. I mean, there's a lot of data that highlights early intervention and complete remission to help the prognostic course of people suffering with depression. So we don't want people walking around on medication side effects or partially treated, because the quality of life and the ongoing course of their illness is much worse than when we get somebody in full remission. Medicines, as we know, are not very effective for depression. Right? I'll talk about the STAR-D trial in a minute, but we have a hard time getting patients up to the proper doses to take the medication compliantly for the amount of time, wait for the medication to kick in, right? And there's lots of reasons for that in terms of the side effect profile. Always say psychiatry sort of has a bad rap in medicine, because our medicines, we get all the side effects up front, all the benefits like 6 to 8 weeks down the line. And so it's a lot of handholding to get patients through that process. For those of you who aren't familiar with the STAR-D trial, this is one of the really best run trials that the NIMH did. It's old now, it was published in 2008, but they did a very concise algorithm of depressants that patients could go through. It was over 2,500 patients, multi-site study, and they started with one antidepressant, and then they had an algorithm of things could be switched. The main take-home point from this study, which really pans out true to this day, and it's really important to be aware of, is that we only capture about 1/3 of the patients with the first antidepressant trial. So when you have 10 patients come into your office with major depression and you put them on their first antidepressant, maybe about 3 of them are going to get better, which is great, those 3, but it leaves 7 untreated. By the time you add a second medication, we can maybe get 2 more. So that means after 2 med trials, which typically take a good 12 weeks for people, and they've typically had depression for a while before they come in, then we're getting about 1/2 of those people into remission. So pretty poor outcomes, right? And not surprisingly, the more trials we have, the more side effects that people can complain of, and the more med dropouts we have in terms of sort of a non-compliance. When we look at treatment-resistant depression as a definition, there's no one universally accepted definition, but in general, like the broad definition is not in remission, right, from your antidepressant trial. Most people will go with the research base is that there's a patient who has had at least two antidepressant trials, adequate dose and duration from two different classes and fails to achieve remission, then that's called a treatment-resistant depression. And we really want to be looking at other interventions to get this person into remission. And it's unlikely that ongoing medication trials are really going to serve them that well. Two quick slides before I go on to TMS, just to point out a little bit of some of the racial and ethnic disparities in mental health care and to remind all of us, right, that we're a big part and how we can help people close these gaps, right? So us paying attention to language barriers that can be different cultural presentations of symptoms and no matter what your specialty is, how they present, and certain racial and ethnic groups that will have a lot of stigma against mental illness in general show up often, right? In a primary care office, neurology office, complaining of maybe more somatic symptoms rather than really being able to talk about mood. Same thing goes, right, with an elderly population. They tend to present much more somatically. And just to highlight a couple stats for some specific populations, right? LGBTQ plus population, 2.5 times more likely to have depression, anxiety, and substance misuse compared to heterosexual individuals. We look at Hispanics, right, are more likely to report poor communication with their healthcare providers. The more of us that can hire bilingual providers would be really fabulous for our current state of mental health. And to look at African Americans, even though they have similar rates in the general population of mental illness, they're much less likely, right, to get evidence-based medication therapies or psychotherapies. All right. I know there's some stuff in the chat, but I'm just going to hold tight and I assume someone's going to yell if they have a question. So for TMS, I'm going to bring you back probably to some of your physics that you remember when you were getting ready for medical school. But Michael Faraday, right, he's credited for the law of magnetic field, electromagnetic induction. And that's really the process that works for TMS on the brain, right? 1985, Anthony Barker is the one who created the first actual TMS device that we could use on humans. It was originally developed for peripheral nerve stimulation, and then the light bulb went off in terms of really using it on the brain. And as I mentioned, in 2008, the first device was cleared. So what do I mean when I'm talking about electromagnetic induction of the brain, right? So what we know that is if you create a magnetic field, like typical, so an MRI field, right, which we know bops hydrogen and you know, water molecules around, but you have an electromagnetic field and you put it next to a conductive substance, which the brain is, right? We have our neurons, which can be stimulated electrically or chemically, right? And you'll create a discharge, right? So what we use is a highly intensively focused magnet, okay? It's an MRI strength magnet, right? And what it looks like, the device, it just is a heavy iron core with a current with wires around it that can be pulsed to create the field. And we can focally target very specific neurons in the brain to get them to fire. So a nice way I like to say it to patients, it's a little bit like physical therapy for the brain, right? So we are way past in neuroscience the idea that depression, anxiety, OCD, addiction are just based on neurotransmissions, right? People used to say a chemical imbalance, right? So we looked at norepinephrine and dopamine and serotonin, right? And GABA now is these primary neurotransmitters. And yes, those are very important, but we understand now in medicine that these illnesses really are more, have more to do with the firing of complete circuits in the brain. And then with that, how different circuits that create networks are firing, and then the connectivity between the networks. And so we learned a lot more in neuroscience about these illnesses, and that monoamine hypothesis is really thought of as one part, as well as other things, inflammation, a lot of other things that we know, neuropeptides. So this is an example of when we're treating depression, we're looking at one specific circuit in the brain that we're targeting, left dorsal lateral prefrontal cortex, and how that's connected with deeper firers to the anterior cyclic gyrus, the amygdala, and then it loops back around. So the way it works with the TMS is we calibrate the device to the patient's head. We do that by finding the place on their brain where we get hand movement on the opposite side. So you guys probably all remember the little picture, like the homunculus on the motor strip of the brain. We take the device, which like see down here, looks like this, the coil. We place it over the head where we get hand movement. We find the specific place on the head where we're getting thumb or hand movement on the opposite side. Then the device moves it forward based on where we want to hit for the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex. Now, if we're treating OCD, we're looking at medial prefrontal cortex. We're looking at different sites, right? There's different sites to target depending on the illness we're treating and depending on what network we have to find. But that's how we sort of we figure out where we're treating on the brain. So it is individualized per person. The motor threshold decides the location where we treat. It also is like the dose. So we all have our own motor threshold. It can vary a little bit with medications, but we consider it sort of a biological marker. Like we all have a temperature we run at or a blood pressure we tend to run at. That's normal for us. And then we dose the device based on a percentage of their motor threshold. So after we find the individual's motor threshold, we move the coil forward to where we're trying to treat, depending on the indication. Then we dose the machine based on that motor threshold, and the protocol has a specific percentage, okay? What the patient does feel during the process is a tapping on the head. So there's nothing really tapping on the head, right? But it's the force of the magnetic energy that's going through the hair and the skin and the scalp and the skull to reach the neurons and to get them to fire. And depending on the protocol too, that's it's not a consistent, it's not constant, right? Protocols, there's an on and off amount to them. So sometimes there's 6 seconds of tapping and maybe 40 seconds of silence, and it goes on like that for about a half hour, right? So in terms of the TMS process, what we love about it, right, it's non-invasive. So they're not taking the medication that's going out throughout their entire body and causing side effects. It's the side effects that we do get are very mild. So like I said, there's that scalp discomfort day one. Sometimes people report a little headache, easily avoidable with some Tylenol or Motrin if they're allowed to take that. Never had anybody quit because of that discomfort or any pain. It hurts a little bit, I would say. It's a weird feeling. After time, the patient comes in, sits down, and the brain sort of ignores that. They know it's safe, and it really doesn't feel like much of anything. People sometimes feel, I hear everything from a tickle to like a woodpecker, right? So it does vary, but we also can start it low and increase it for tolerability. The only other side effect that we sometimes see with TMS is after about day 3, 4, 5, people can feel a little tired. Not so tired that it interrupts their day, but a little fatigue. And I equate it again. It's like if you go to the gym and have a big workout that you feel a little tired, you know, their brain is working hard to fire differently and change the firing. And that can cause a little bit of fatigue. But overall, it's well tolerated, right? Non-invasive, non-systemic. People drive themselves to and from, no anesthesia, no sedation, a completely outpatient procedure. And the only contraindication, we'll talk a little bit more about this, is they can have no ferromagnetic material in and around the head. So if they cannot have an MRI, right, unfortunately, they cannot do TMS because it will pull the device out, right? So it's very rare now. Maybe elderly people could have some aneurysm clips, but other than that, it's pretty unlikely. The actual procedure for the patient is they come every day, right? They come 5 days a week. Like I said, they're in and out in about a half hour, can drive themselves to and from. Doesn't interfere with any activities. Most practices are open a good amount of time. We're open 7 to 7. So it's very easy to fit in before work, after work, lunch break. And they come that long for 6 weeks. And then the next 3 weeks, there's like a 6-session taper. So there's 36 sessions altogether. And most people, which is also the huge advantage for TMS over medications, start feeling better within about the first 10 treatments. So after 2 weeks, we track rating scales, right? Depression rating scales like the PHQ-9 or the anxiety rating scales, GAD-7. And we track those every 2 weeks. And we usually see about a 30% decrease in the first 2 weeks. So much more rapid response than we get with medications, right? Medications, usually the first 2 weeks, we're just getting somebody barely up to a therapeutic dose. And then we're telling them to wait 3 to 6 weeks for it to kick in. So it really helps patients. I think the lack of side effects and the rapidity of the response really is helpful for these patients, just in terms of inspiring hope. At Neuro Wellness Spa, we also, since we have patients there and they're sitting there 5 days a week for like a half hour, we take the opportunity to do a lot more wellness and education about other wellness. So we have sort of a clinical initiative, and we talk to them about just literally their depression, first of all, and making sure they have insight and what are the first symptoms they see so that they can, if they're having a recurrence, they can come back quickly. But we also go over nutrition. We talk about exercise, spiritual well-being, social interaction, you know, sense of purpose, really to try to capture every element we can in terms of getting them into full remission. And when they're recovering from depression, right, a lot of those things have fallen by the wayside. And so it's sort of getting them back into the real world and engaging, because those are the things in my mind that are going to keep them right in remission the longest. The potential side effect that I didn't mention that some people are aware of with TMS is a risk of seizure. And it's so rare. It's actually less than with medications at this point. It was thought of to be a bigger risk when it first came out a long time ago. Now we've treated thousands and thousands and thousands of people, multiple sessions. And it's very rare to have a seizure unless the coil's placed incorrectly, bottom line, maybe the patient hasn't been completely honest about like alcohol use. If somebody comes in and they're, you know, they maybe stop their alcohol abruptly, you know, they want to be a really good patient. They haven't maybe been completely honest about their alcohol use. They have been drinking every day. They stop it abruptly. They come, they're in that sort of withdrawal period and we're stimulating their brain. And maybe they're short on sleep, any of those things that can lower seizure threshold. Okay. Then there's a little bit more of a risk for a seizure. Never had a seizure at Neuro Wellness Spa. Thank goodness, shouldn't jinx myself. And we've done over 100,000 TMS sessions. And so I think it's really just know your patient and make sure your staff is well-trained when they're applying the coils. So there's really no absolute contraindication, like I said, unless you have ferromagnetic objects within 30 centimeters of the coil, which is pretty much around the head. We can do TMS with pacemakers and VNS systems and spinal cord stimulators. Sometimes there's a little work we have to do with the device manufacturers to turn things on and off, make sure they're not controlled in different ways, or put magnets over the pacemakers to shut it off during. We can treat with skull plates even. We don't treat right over the plate, but we can do a different sided protocol. And like you said, the seizure risk is actually less than we have with some medications. In terms of response and remission rates at Neuro Wellness Spa, we get a 74% response rate. Okay. That's defined by the reduction in the PHQ-9, right? So our objective rating scale, 50% reduction in that is called a response. An absolute value of 0 to 4 goes up to 27, right? So 4 and below is considered remission. So when you look at this compared to medications, right, where we get a 30% remission, 30% remission rate after one trial, maybe a little bit less than a 50% remission after two trials, like these are really good results. As I mentioned, the very first FDA indication was for major depression, and that came out in 2008. And since then, as you can see, we have a lot more indications on the table. They're not all covered currently by insurances, unfortunately. Depression are usually pretty much completely covered. Several insurance companies cover obsessive compulsive disorder really well. Anxious depression, absolutely covered. The peripheral nerve pain recently came out. It's a little bit of a different device than what we have in terms of the chair. But I think my understanding of cigarette cessation and peripheral nerve pain and migraine with aura aren't necessarily covered by insurance currently. We hope we'll get there. Another thing I wanted to mention is the SAINT protocol, and this is credited to Dr. Nolan Williams. He's up at Stanford, and this is sort of a different application of TMS, the same TMS protocol, though, where patients can come and get all sessions done in 5 days. This currently is not covered by insurance. It would be a cash pay model, but it was really formulated for hospitals, right? Because I think when you think about most other specialties, people going into the hospitals are receiving higher levels of care and intervention. Whereas with psychiatry, unfortunately, our hospitals end up a lot being a little bit just containment, right, for safety. There's nothing really you can do faster. You can, you know, diagnose, you can get some rule outs of some organic diseases, but if you're going to start a medication, right, it's far from in place or working when the person is discharged. Typically now hospital stay, right, 5 or 8 days later. So the Stanford protocol was really created for an inpatient use, and hopefully we're getting there. They just got granted their CPT codes. And so the idea is the patients come in, they do 10 sessions a day for 5 days, so 50 sessions, and they have really, really good results. So I just sort of want to put that in to let you know, I think, where this is going and hopefully the utility of this in terms of the tolerability and the rapid efficacy in terms of psychiatry is amazing. I will switch gears a bit now and look at magnetic e-resonance therapy, right? Same exact TMS device, same technology, right? Using a high intensive magnetic field targeted and focused to stimulate specific neural circuits and eventually networks in the brain. But with the magnetic e-resonance therapy, we're personalizing it a little bit more by doing a quantitative EEG, that then we get a quantitative EEG after for that specific patient. So like I mentioned with the regular TMS, there are set fixed protocols more based on diagnosis. So there's a depression protocol, there's an OCD protocol, cigarette cessation protocol, there's pain management, cognitive decline protocols. But with MERT, we're doing the EEG, and then we send the EEG off to the lab, and they send back a specific protocol in terms of placement and pulse frequency for that individual's brain. So even though we consider it not diagnostically driven, it obviously is more appropriate for certain diagnoses. Most of these tend to be more global. So where we get amazing results with MERT are for people on the spectrum. So autistic spectrum disorder, the cognitive declines, Parkinson's disease, Alzheimer's. I'm treating a gentleman with progressive aphasia, and he's doing really well. It's amazing for PTSD. We're getting really good. There's some big FDA trials now on EEG guided TMS for PTSD. And we also then traumatic brain injury and tinnitus, which we wouldn't consider so global, but we don't get the same efficacy with the regular TMS. So people that come for traumatic brain injury do really well with MERT, as well as we get good results with tinnitus, which is very difficult to treat. The tinnitus protocol is only 10 days, unlike the other ones, which tend to be 30 to 40 sessions. So patients come for 2 weeks, five times a week for 10, and they're done. MERT is really, other than that, it's the same, right? Non-systemic, non-invasive. They come, we know that they're getting their treatment, which is important, unlike a medication. It's a little bit of a longer treatment, usually in and out about 40 minutes rather than 30 minutes. But same thing, no interference in their daily activities. I already mentioned the primary indications. Insomnia, I left that one out. I don't tend to just treat primary insomnia, but it has really good efficacy for insomnia. When you treat the autistic children, you'll see, like, that's one of the first thing that parents say. They just start like crying because their kids are sleeping through the night, which they haven't had in years. People use it just for peak performance. We've had amazing COVID results, post-COVID. And so I think this is, I'm going to show you that. So this is an example of what we see in the quantitative EEGs based on different indications, right? So far left here, this is sort of what we expect. A nice sharp peak in the alpha range. We're doing an alpha EEG, right? So this person around maybe 10.5%. And from posterior to frontal, the graphs look about the same. And that would be you know, a typical EEG. And then this is just some examples of obviously they're not exactly what we see, but indications. So here this person clearly had, right, like a frontal traumatic brain injury. He slowed way down, he or she slowed way down here. It starts pulling the rest of the brain back, and we're seeing a lot more frontal and central slowing. Addiction, we tend to see a lot of frontal central slowing around 6.5 hertz. In the theta range, and autism, just the absence of development of frontal alpha in general. And I just threw this in. This was actually a staff member who unfortunately got COVID twice, but got COVID in the spring of 2021. And that is not a very great looking EEG, as you can see. Lost a lot of amplitude, a lot of slowing. This is a young person, 41, should not be down here at 8. And then came in the May is the red one behind here, and June is the final. So really was able to, you can see, really improve the firing, the synchronicity of the firing, the amplitude there, sped up a little bit, still should be slower. And then unfortunately she got COVID again in the fall, and saw like sort of slip back and then popped right back up with treatment. So I just like to show that one because obviously post-COVID, we're still dealing with a lot of long COVID and what some of the interventions can be. What time is it? Okay, good, we're doing well. So I tried to cover most of this. Like I say, you'll have your slides. I want to leave time for questions too and go on. But bottom line, anybody is a good TMS candidate if they haven't, if they're not 100% better on their medications, right? Or they're having side effects, right? Ideally, it's covered with we can usually get it covered with, you know, they've had two antidepressant trials, sometimes one, because when you talk to them, they've had one farther back or they've taken a different one for sleep, they don't realize. But to me, anybody who isn't in full remission or is having side effects on their medications is great for TMS, and has those diagnoses, right? Depression, OCD, if they want it covered by insurance. Those other indications, if they don't have a comorbid depression, then obviously it would be a cash pay service. But if it's a depression with TBI, we can get it covered. If it's autism and TBI and they're an adult, I should have said 18 and over, we can get it covered. We talked about the side effects of it. No, we don't have risk of hearing loss. Patients do wear earplugs. There's also a head support pillow that also goes around the head. So the sound is very muted when the patient's in the chair, even though the coil is very close to their ears. If somebody has seizure disorder and it's stable, right? So it's treated by their medications, they absolutely can do TMS. It's not a contraindication. Bipolar disorder, it's to me, this is one of the indications it definitely should have. Sadly, right, it doesn't have that. So that doesn't get covered by insurance. And it's important to know that the patient needs to be on a mood stabilizer, right? So probably everybody in the audience appreciates the fact that if somebody has a bipolar depression unlike unipolar depression, if they start an antidepressant, the risk is that they become hypomanic or manic, right? So anything that can increase a mania, sleep deprivation, steroid use, or an antidepressant, right, could result. TMS is a really powerful antidepressant, right? So as long as they're on a mood stabilizer, though, we get amazing results with bipolar disorder. Often they don't need as many treatments. They can pop back into remission. And the huge advantage you get is they're not left on an antidepressant, which creates a lot of instability for their bipolar disorder. So anybody who is treating people with bipolar disorder, as friends, family with it, you understand that we start an antidepressant, they get a little bit better, then they tend to rev up, then we have to stop the antidepressant or we have to put them on an antipsychotic, which has its own side effects. And it's sort of a back and forth. And we know over time, the more exposure a person with bipolar disorder has with antidepressants, the more brittle their bipolar disorder becomes. And so we really try to avoid in psychiatry antidepressants. The problem is these people get really depressed. Their depressions are often worse than even just the unipolars. They're fast and deep and dark, and there's a higher risk of unfortunately completed suicides with bipolar disorder than unipolar disorder. Dental fillings, piercing, tattoos, completely fine with TMS. TMS is not a cure, right? We understand that depression, like hypertension, like diabetes, is a chronic illness, a chronic remitting illness. And the point is to get it into full remission and then maintain it there. Typically, about 80% of people will last a full year. Okay. Obviously, the more they're doing to stay in remission in terms of, like we said, exercise, nutrition, help, socialization, purpose in life, engagement, you know, not drinking a lot of alcohol, protecting their sleep is going to help. But, you know, at some point, they're likely to have a recurrence. And when they just notice a few of those symptoms coming, they can come back and do another round of TMS. Once authorized by insurance for TMS, then they do not have to go through additional medication trials. So that's the really cool thing. So once the insurance company understands that they failed medications and TMS has worked for them, tests have worked for them, at least a response, then they can come back and do TMS really for most people up to twice a year, covered by insurance without the need to go through ongoing or additional medication trials. I mentioned we track objective rating scales to look at the outcomes. And during TV, they're full, I mean, during TMS, they're fully alert and awake. And we do have TVs in the room that they can watch. We obviously, usually they're in with the tech and they're talking. They can read, they can do work. It gives you a good sense of how tolerable the treatment is. Mentioned already, feels like a tapping on the head. Some people say sort of like a little tickle. Other people say a woodpecker. We obviously try to have people maintain sobriety during, it is okay to have a glass. So, you know, if they don't have an addiction, we eat a social glass of wine or whatever on a Friday and Saturday is fine. We don't want anybody drinking. You know, if they go to a big party and have more drinks than typical, we would just say, just skip TMS that day. We typically are adding TMS to their current medication regimen. So obviously we peel off things that aren't working or causing a lot of side effects. But if they have one medication that they feel has partially helped them and that they're tolerating, the idea is to add the TMS to the medication and get them into full remission and then use that medication ongoing as a further way to prevent a recurrence of illness. We want to avoid, obviously, somebody on tons of polypharmacy. And if they're coming in and they're meeting criteria for depression and they're on 3 or 4 meds, and we already know, like, really things should come off. And I see that a lot also in treatment that, you know, I think as physicians, we're really trying to do everything we can for patients. And when they're not getting better, people just keep adding and adding and adding without ever taking away. And so it is really good to clean up their medications. They usually feel better cognitively and get rid of side effects. I've seen some people who come to me on 5 or 6 medications and I'm like, hey, before we do TMS, let's peel some of those off. And they literally feel 50% better just getting on, you know, down to 1 or 2, because they don't even realize over time with the additions sort of what some things are side effects and they're really not actually symptoms of the illness. We already talked about this. Okay, another big important thing, like when you're referring, like I just really want TMS to be on your minds. And hopefully I piqued your interest to keep following the research on this, because I think the expanded indications and the cross fields that we're going to hit are going to be really fascinating. But if you have patients and you're referring them to TMS, some good things to sort of encourage them to think about when they're going for their consult would be, you know, obviously the site, like how much experience do they have? What device do they use and what protocols? Because there are different devices in terms of safety and efficacy. MagVenture, NeuroStar, and BrainSway are the top 3, I would say, that have been out the longest. There's many, many more. I think there's all 13 on the market. They can't all do the same things. They don't all offer the same protocols. Making sure that they're going to a place that's contracted with insurance. There's no, you know, people should not have to be paying cash if they're an adult and doing it for a insurance covered indication. At Neuro Wellness Spa, the medical directors always calibrate and always recalibrate the device. Typically, most insurances pay for a calibration. 2 weeks later, they pay for a recalibration. Some do that twice. We just check that motor threshold. And at our site, the doctors are seeing the patients every 2 weeks. They're on site so they can see them whenever if needed, but it's really important to really have a medical, I think, professional in there. There are some sites where the patient might see the doctor day one, who can do the consult, the prescription, and then they're with the tech for the next, you know, 9 weeks. And I think a little bit more oversight is better. Obviously, how close the, you know, it's a procedure that requires patients to go 5 days a week. And so it needs to be convenient enough for them. So good parking, right? How close is it? What are the hours? And like you said, we're open 7 to 7. And we're not open on weekends. We have excellent parking. I think those things are really important. I want to take a few more minutes. I'll just talk a little bit about your behavioral health, which includes Neuro Wellness Spa, Clear Behavioral Health, and Sober Living. And so the idea, which is New Life House. So the idea is really, as mentioned, really we try to grasp in an insurance-based model, really a continuity of care that we can. So at Neuro Wellness Spa, we do the telepsychiatry. We can do in-person psychiatry. We have medication management. We have the TMS and we have the MERT. We can consult on other treatment-resistant depression interventions like Spravato, ibuprofen, the ECT, DBS, and VNS, as well as psychedelic therapy. And we're really proud that we can get people in very quickly. I know it's very hard to get patients into psychiatrists now that accepted insurance, and we really do. The rate limiting factor is really them completing their intake documentation. We have 9 sites all across from Westlake, Encino down to Long Beach. We're opening soon in Pasadena and Westchester and hopefully Orange County. We have 6 medical directors, all board certified. We do provide 24-hour, 24/7 coverage in terms of the patients in-house, if they ever need something on the evenings or the weekends. And we have, well, actually have 13. We just started a new nurse practitioner on Monday, but the 12 that we had when I did the slide. So we have 13 primary mental health nurse practitioners that are working on our sites. And we under the YBH umbrella, we have Clear Behavioral Health. And so with Clear Behavioral Health, we have mental health residentials. We have 2, 1 in Torrance and 1 in Manhattan Beach. We have detox and substance use residents. So we keep those are separate facilities. And we have that in Redondo, soon opening in Gardenia. Then we have step down for PHP and IOP levels of care for adults, mental health, also substance use or dual diagnosis. We have adolescent, not residential, but adolescent PHP IOPs. And then we offer the psychiatry for anybody who's coming in on that level. One thing I should mention on the neuro wellness side, that if you guys want to see a device or want to see a place in, you know, in person, our Long Beach office is having an open house next week on Thursday, 11:30 to 1 in Long Beach. And you can reach out and we can give you more information. But in terms of the YBH model, what's really nice is people can come in at many touch points and we can make sure they get really rapid wraparound services, with really good continuity of care. So to close up, please remember, right, mental wellness is super important. We do not get great results with medications. Think of alternative treatments for your patients if they're not in full remission, or even if they're in remission and having medication side effects or other things that can improve their quality of life. And we have a lot of good safety and efficacy data of TMS, clearly for depression, OCD, autism, cognitive decline, TBI. And so keep those in mind when you're referring your patients. And I will stop sharing and see if we have any questions. I think I left us like 15 minutes.
There's a ton of questions and it'll probably go over. So you cut me off when you need to, Dr. Ku. That was phenomenal.
No problem. Thank you.
I was getting a lot of questions actually texted to me on top of the Q&A. Okay. My partner, Dr. Tarpley, asked a question that a lot of us on the neuroscience side went to. You talked about so many of the different indications. We're really interested in seeing what the potential applications are for this for post-stroke patients, particularly, yeah, you know, in the realm of aphasia. I know that's not what you talked about here, but would you mind commenting on that a little bit?
Yeah. You know, since I'm not a neurologist, I haven't spent a lot of my time and experience using the TMS for that, but you could really Google that and you will see there is a lot of good research. There's a lot of publications on post-stroke rehab and people using it for faster recoveries. Obviously you wait a certain amount of time after the stroke for a little recovery, but not too long. Mm-hmm. The idea is to get it in early and recruit the surrounding stimulating neural tissues, right, to take over with really good results. And so, like to me, that's one of the best indications. We have same thing with TBI. You want a little recovery. You don't want to wait too long and you want to get the people in the chair. I mean, if I had my druthers, people in the sports, right? Football players and hockey players and soccer players, like off season should all be coming and doing TMS. Absolutely. It's crazy. Or MERT. I do have a primary progressive aphasia patient that I'm treating now with the MERT, and we're targeting around the area, and he is doing, he's 84 and he's doing quite well. He made a lot of improvement. He still is a little staccato in his speech. He's clearly not deteriorating. He does come now twice a month. So he comes continuously. So bottom line, yes, there's a lot of good research and efficacy, and I think it's a fabulous indication.
When you talked about the for shunts, because of the magnetic aura and the dials can get changing the setting and the pressures for which they work or the flow, depending on the type of valve, if this is coordinated with neurosurgery, would that be considered if we can get them in quickly?
Yes. And so same thing, if they have... With most, we can do the TMS. If they do have a magnetically controlled valve, it can be a little tricky. I think that's the one issue that's hard. What we do need to do, though, even if it's not that controlled, we are supposed to be checking like after each TMS, right? You're supposed to be checking the functioning and the pressures. But yes, that's feasible to do.
With the MRI safe machines now, I anticipate that'll be less and less of an issue. We've completely switched to the MRI compatible shunts for the last probably 5 years now. Beautiful. So it should be good. Dr. Jayla asked, could you comment on so-called mesodiencephalic modulation for electrical stimulation used overseas? They claim it increases immunity in the immunodeficiency state. I didn't know that. Any experience in that? And does magnetic stimulation affect the immune system?
That's a really good question. And I don't have the actual data for the direct, but I'll sort of talk about what I do know, which is obviously neuroimmunology is a big field. We know that depression has a lot to do with sort of the autoimmune system and the immune system in general. So I don't know of any actual studies that look at TMS and how that's changing the immune system. But I will say that most of us do believe that, and I don't know if it's a chicken or egg, we could have a whole discussion also right now about the microbiome and the gut, like what's really influencing what. But so I don't know. I mean, I should just like, I don't know for a fact. So, and I'm not familiar with that research from Europe, but I'll look it up. So thank you.
Really interesting. I didn't. Dr. Walensky's got a few great questions here. Does the device find the dorsolateral frontal cortex, or does the human, and then what's the typical distance in front of the precentral gyrus that's used?
Perfect. So the device, there's lots of ways to do the calibration. I sort of went over this quickly. It goes everywhere from there's certain devices that use neural navigation where you can send the patient to have an MRI and do neural navigation. Now that would be important, like if you're treating post-stroke, right? Because that's not a set fixed place on the brain. That's very individualized and people would want to use a neural navigated device. It's not for the typical protocols that are insurance covered, that for like a depression, OCD, neuronavigation is not needed. And really it's not recommended because then you're asking the patient now to pay like $5,000 to get an MRI because that would not be covered. So the way we calibrate, there are several ways. You can use each device has its calibration method, and it's based on the MT and moving the coil forward, usually 5.5 centimeters. We also have, we call it the beam method. And so you can measure the brain, and there's actually even an app where you put in the certain measurements. It's called the beam method, and you can mark the spot that way if you prefer. Most people just use the device setting. And then there was a question about distance. So most devices are 5.5 centimeters forward from the motor threshold location, but there was something else about, I think, a gyrus or...
It was specifically related to the type of metric that it was used. So is the head measured with the 10 to 20 system?
Yes, that head is, if you do the beam method, then yes, you're sort of, you're not using the EEG 1020 system, it's beam, but you are taking centimeters and you're doing nasium to inium and you're doing right, ear to ear. And then you put in the mathematical ways to do it that way if you want. We don't alter, like, there's so much about, right, that's still in neuroscience. Just, I mean, it's just fascinating to me when sort of they do a lot of studies now. They've created devices that they can use within MRIs, like on research purposes, to mm-hmm. look at the electrical conductivity of the neurons, right, surface. And you see that there's so much we still don't understand. I simplified things greatly, but, like, we typically know that a high frequency, like 20 hertz intermittent protocol, tends to be excitatory for the brain. And when we do a low frequency, like 1 hertz protocol, that's not intermittent, that's continuous, that tends to be inhibitory. But you'll see about 20% of the population, it's different. If you're treating right over a gyrus over a sulci, because of the cerebrospinal fluid, you get a little different spread, right? So it's really interesting. We like to simplify these things and say, oh, this is an excitatory protocol and we're treating there. And we know it's a lot more complicated than that. But in the end, I think hopefully there are people trying to do that. They're also trying to, rather than look at really a spot to treat on the brain, because we know so much more about the connectomes and the interconnectivity, they're really looking at now sometimes treating places that are like the most anti-correlated or correlated, right, yeah, with different parts of the brain. So there's so much ongoing research. I think we're going to know a lot more in the decades to come, but at least the primitive system we have now actually ends up with pretty good results for the vast majority of people.
I'm glad you mentioned
things
that.
You can tweak. Like if I have somebody who's not responding to a high intensity left protocol, sometimes I just switch them to a right-sided low intensity and I get really good results. And so that's why when you're looking at places, you do want to understand the device and what protocols they can use and sort of their experience, because there's things we can do to individualize just based on experience.
We've had two lectures in the last couple of years about the field of connectomics, and we actually have some representatives from Omniscion here.
Oh, cool.
Big player in the field. So I know they were interested in your talk here.
Perfect.
Dr. Yazdi asked, could you talk a little bit about the cost of treatment? I know that's a significant point to discuss.
Yeah. So like you said, for most people, like if you're coming in for, if you have a diagnosis of depression and you're 18 or older, then we can actually bill insurance and it's covered anywhere from 100%. The most I've seen really as a copay is like $20 a time, which obviously can add up. That's $100 a week for patients. And it's a 9 week, well, the last three aren't 5 times. So it's a little less than that, but you know, that can be costly, but in general, it's fully recovered. And we can also work with patients if there's a little bit of that copay. Obviously if somebody has a deductible that they haven't met, unfortunately that cost is going to be there. When we're talking about a treatment that can't be covered by insurance. So let's say, and I've gotten even with peer to peer, some 17-year-olds, 16-year-olds covered, but let's say if they're teens or we're treating for like a primary progressive aphasia, we're treating for an Alzheimer's, in general, it's about $400 a session. And we say 20 to 30 sessions. We're not set with the 36 or 38 insurance protocol, but I would say most people need about 30. So you're talking about 10 grand for the entire process. And we don't charge extra. Like if they're doing the MERD, we don't do an added cost for the EEGs, or it's not an added cost for the doctor visits. It's sort of all included and happens on location.
Dr. Nelson asks, for patients with major depression and migraine headaches, is there any evidence that this treatment, presumably related to the depression treatment, affects the frequency intensity of the migraine? It's a great question.
Yeah, that's a great question. Yeah. And people with migraine are often afraid that it's going to induce it, and it actually treats it. So it's a really good question. Like I say, there is a device that's specifically now FDA cleared for migraine with aura. I was in a really early study with a neurologist, and we looked at TMS for migraine. Now we were doing the regular depression protocol, and it was really interesting. It was a really good study. We did 3 months prior, they had to record all their migraines, severity, rescue meds, meds they were on. They did the TMS. We were recording the same things. And then we followed them 3 months after. Very interesting. Everybody during the entire time of the TMS had far fewer migraines, far fewer leads for medications. Unfortunately, what we discovered is it seemed over the next 90 days that the frequency and the severity sort of came back. So I don't recommend TMS as a treatment for migraine. What I do tell patients, though, very confidently is that if they're doing TMS and they have a migraine and they can tolerate, like we can dim the lights for them and, you know, but they can tolerate the noise, I say come in because you will not leave with a migraine. So it's really cool for that respect. So it doesn't tend to increase migraines when people have them, and it actually can really help treat it, you know, in an acute migraine. But once again, my study was old and it was a different protocol. So take that for what it is, but it certainly doesn't worsen it. And then, as we know, I think people with depressed have more migraines. And so if they're not depressed, I do think that helps.
You think that's the works the same for major depression and generalized anxiety disorder similarly?
Yes.
Wonderful.
Yeah.
Wonderful.
Yeah. Yeah. Very effective for anxiety. Incredibly so.
Dr. Briganthi asks, what psych meds are contraindicated with TMS? Are there, do you not give them with TMS or?
No, there are none that are contraindicated. Obviously, high dose Wellbutrin, right? We watch a little bit because it lowers the seizure threshold. High dose benzos we like to avoid. There is efficacy there is evidence that there's reduced efficacy with TMS with high dose benzos. So if somebody's like on a milligram of Klonopin, fine. If they're on 3 or 4, we definitely want to taper that down. So not a contraindication, but certainly wouldn't be recommended. Stimulants are fine, right? It can change. Mood stabilizers and stimulants can change the motor threshold a little bit. It's fine, but you leave them on. We treat. If they have a major change in those medications, you would obviously make sure you're repeating the motor threshold.
Dr. Ross asks, is there a specific use with pacemakers and defibrillators? I know you mentioned 30 centimeters from the actual handheld coil. Is that sort of the general rule of thumb?
Yeah. So if they have a pacemaker in there, we do try to, sometimes it depends on the device. Like sometimes the pacemaker place has given me a big magnet and I can tape it over the chest. It will just deactivate the device for the time they're in their chair. We've done that. Some places, if they're just like a pacemaker that's set, if they obviously their heart rate goes down too low, it kicks in, like those can be turned off during the time. So it is feasible to do. We typically do want to obviously disenable the pacemaker.
Yeah, absolutely.
The recordings are going to be very weird, right? Same thing, diabetic, right? We can do it with implantable. We have them take off their, right, the insulin pump devices.
With Dr. Robertson also asked, but I think you've answered in the last one in terms of the response rates of migraines with and without aura and how long the benefits persist. I think that data is still being gathered.
Yeah. Yeah.
Dr. Walensky, how is the optimal stimulus intensity determined? Interesting.
Yeah, so we do the motor thresholds defined as the least amount of energy required to get that hand or thumb twitch on the opposite side. And it's an absolute value, like right from the TMS device. So if it's 50, let's just say, then the protocol has a percentage. So if I'm treating for depression with a single pulse protocol, I'll do 120%. So that person's getting treated at 60, right? Their motor threshold's 50. That answered the question.
Mm-hmm. No, that was good. That was good. Another question, does the machine used make a difference in the disease outcome? I guess there's commercial services that offer to bring their machines to the doctor's offices. Are you familiar with how those results may differ from yours?
You know, there aren't a lot of head-to-head trials comparing the device manufacturers outside of they get wrapped in. So you have to show non-inferiority, right? So I think the way I would say that is you would want to pick a device to me, at least that has a non-inferiority research on it. And different devices are FDA cleared for different indications based on that. Not everybody knows that, right? So there are devices that do TMS and they're out there, but it would be wise to sort of say, well, is your device actually FDA cleared for that indication? Because they're not all cleared for the same things. They've had to prove an efficacy in comparison to a major research trial that have gotten the FDA indication.
I would just like to reiterate my support from your statement about having more specific medical physician oversight, you know, in these processes, you know, which lends the the segue to the next question of what is the minimum medical training needed for a person to perform the TMS? Does it vary by state? And where do they usually go to get trained?
Yay, I love that question because I love training and I'm the vice president, soon to be president of the Clinical TMS Society. And so that's look up the Clinical TMS Society. It's an amazing organization. And obviously there are other courses, but we have a pulses course, which is amazing. Most, there aren't really requirements. It's like all of us in medicine, you know, you better just be well-trained, right? So the device manufacturers do have training that they will do for you and with you. I would argue that's probably not sufficient, right? To just start treating patients. It would be good to take another course and get a certification. And then obviously, hopefully work with someone over time, just for the experience. But it, bottom line, it's, if you're interested, I would say do it. It's an amazing technology. The device will help you with training, and there are courses out there, but look up the Clinical TMS Society. There, our pulses course is pretty amazing.
You know, we've talked about a lot of different treatments here. I'd like to highlight the ones that are, you know, in terms of having them give the speaks, you know, having them give the talks in the discussion, like psychedelics, for example, where the safety threshold is so, you know, great. What we're working on is just fine-tuning where it's going to be useful and where the next 10 years of neuroscience is going to be, in my opinion.
Right. Agreed.
Maybe even more. Have you tried this treatment for vestibular neuronitis?
I have not.
Interesting. That one, that was a good question there. Has MERT been shown to have better results in diseases like PTSD compared to TMS without that?
They're not head-to-head trials, but I would, just from me having done this for the past 15 years, I would say the MERT is definitely superior when it comes to the PTSD. It's pretty interesting. And bottom line, I think it's just because the protocols that we have to use are it's just different, a different protocol, right, than we get with the other device in terms of where we're treating. And I think it all boils down to that.
Dr. Ross asks, is there any data with ADHD in device use?
You know, there is, some people will say, once again, this is sort of personal experience. There's a whole device brain sway that has a helmet for ADHD. I don't feel we get amazing results. So I don't like to, if people say, oh, can I do it just for my ADHD? Now, it's great for the depression. It's great for the anxiety. When we treat that, I think people do focus and concentrate better. But I think the issue with ADHD is we're not quite sure yet where to treat. It's such a global phenomenon in the brain, right? With the using, you know, there's the reticular activating system and the attentional component, as well as the executive functioning up front. I think that's what makes it tricky. So I see people feel better, but I think it's because their depression and anxiety is better, which are very comorbid. And I wouldn't say specifically ADHD. Now the MERT for specific learning disabilities, absolutely. So neurodivergence and learning disabilities, the MERT does help significantly.
Interesting. And I think we've gone through, let me just make sure before I get to this last question, which is basically going to close us out here. Pamela Corey, who is your primary director, who's been phenomenal, has put the contact information, if you're interested in reaching out to Dr. Ku and her team. She put her phone number and the email, and that's the number that I've been using directly. And anytime I have a patient who would benefit from any of the overarching brand's work, I've just been sending her a text with the information, and the coordination of care has been phenomenal. So really, you know, reaching that concierge level style of practice, which myself as a referring doctor and the patients truly, truly appreciate. So please look at that in your chat box on the side. Oh, another question popped up in the meantime. Any data in oppositional defiant or sociopathic personality disorder?
Really good question too. Well, you know, with borderline, we get a lot of really help with the TMS. But once again, I think it's mainly treating the depression, the anxiety, and then the actual, don't underestimate, they get like brief therapy. They're in the room, right? 5 days a week. So no specific work on antisocial personality disorder that I know. Oppositional defiant, we tends to be in kids, right? And so I don't have a lot of experience with that. TMS is very safe in kids. We use it a lot with autism, three years and up. They really need to be able to at least sit for the EEG. But I don't know of any work specifically on antisocial personality disorder.
Dr. Credidio asked about the recording of the Dr. Koo has graciously agreed to allow for the recording of this, and it will be up on the PNI website. And Dr. Cordelia, I'll text you a link to the YouTube site as soon as we get it up. We've been getting them up more efficiently now, so it'll be up soon. And then, so I think a good way to close this discussion would be, could you just quickly go over the mechanism of TMS again? I know you talked about it, but I think this would be the take-home message for a lot of people.
Awesome. Yeah, and I really appreciate that. So once again, shorthand version, maybe for patients to understand, we think of it like physical therapy for the brain. Mm-hmm. We're using a high-intensity magnet, and we're focally targeting a specific neurocircuit in the brain to get the neurons to fire as they should. So we know enough, right, in neuroscience to know that depression is a result of sort of faulting communication and wiring between certain neural networks in the brain and neurocircuit. Same thing with OCD, same thing with PTSD. So we take this high intensity magnet, we focally target the specific neurons we want to fire, and then we just get them moving. And the person comes every day, 5 days a week, to sort of get that firing the way it should.
Love it. Love it. That was awesome, Dr. Koo. Thank you so much for doing this. And I think this relationship, and just for as a resource for all of the Providence, Southern California hospitals, this is going to grow tremendously given the need. You know, really, it's going to be, in my opinion, your bandwidth that's going to limit, but you're growing. You're keeping up with that like that. And as you know, Providence, Southern California ranges from North Valley all the way down to the bottom of Orange County. And you seem to be, you know, expanding in concordance with that, which is going to be amazing. Yeah. So thank you all.
Thank you all
for joining us today. Phenomenal neuroscience grand rounds. If there are any other questions, please email or call or text me, and I'll make sure we get it out to Dr. Koo and Pamela to get some answers. The referral information is listed in the chat box, but reach out if there's any question about that. And we will see you next month, second Tuesday, for the next neuroscience grand rounds. Bye, everyone.
Bye.
Thank you.
We hope to see-